you. I'm Hayley Palmer. It's so good to have you here with me on tonight's show, especially as we are joined by the brilliant Pete Wiley. And here is what happened when I caught up with him. Pete Wiley, it's great to have you on the show. How are you?
I'm good, Hayley. How are you?
I'm really good, thank you. We wanted to get you on the show for a long time. It's taken me about 6 months to track you down. How dare you?
It's been a fantastic 6 months. That's the only reason. I wanted to be here from day one and every day since.
But... Well, the reason I wanted to get you on the show, because on your Twitter, it actually says part-time rock star, full-time legend.
Indeed.
And I'm like, right, we really need to see if, you know, he's the real deal.
I can't help it. I was born this way. When Elvis and Betty Page got together and gave birth to me 9 months later, there was no real choice in my life to be anything but a rock star. But part-time, because I can't be bothered with some sides of it. Can't be bothered with... I don't like business. I'm not very good at it.
Okay.
Well, I'm, you know.
Okay.
But yes,
you can't have it
everything's
all.
Fine. Everything's fine.
Amazing. And I'm liking the shirt tonight. You made the effort
shirt,
for us.
It's a very special shirt. It's a Keith Haring shirt. Keith Haring, New York graffiti artist, who I love. And, yeah, I've got the hat. The hat's there somewhere behind me.
Oh, right.
And, yeah, I've got the trainers, the baseball boots. I've got the lot of Keith Haring. I've loved him since the 80s. And I was in New York a lot in the 80s, obviously, and like a lot of us were. And that's where I first saw his stuff, and I've been a fan ever since. Massive exhibition at the Tate Gallery 2 years ago, which was stunning. You know, one of the best things ever. There you go.
Like it. And obviously we sort of come out of lockdown. I think I read in an interview somewhere that you enjoyed lockdown. Was that right?
I kind of did for a while. I liked it because I saved some energy because, I'm kind of a high-energy person. So I often, when I socialise or when I go to the shops, I can spend 2 hours talking to the woman on the till in Tesco.
Oh, I'm the same.
Yeah, good.
I can't get out of Tesco's.
We were made for each other. And so, lockdown to me was give me time to think, work a few things out. I've done a lot of recording. I did some useful business things during that time, including... I've licensed my catalogue. I own a lot of the songs I recorded and the albums I recorded. And I've done a deal with Chrysalis, so they're going to be coming out on vinyl and in box sets and all that stuff. And they're good people, the people behind that now. And then writing, and I did some of those 80s festivals, Rewind and Let's Rock. And
I love them.
Yeah,
they're
I had a ball.
Good.
They really are. They're great. And the band was great, and the people running it was just brilliant. Plus, massive for me was seeing people I hadn't seen for lots of time.
Like a school reunion.
Yeah, well, you know, I left London like easily 20 years ago. I have hardly been back to London, certainly not, except when I'm playing. I go, obviously, I can't really play without being there. But, ran into Martin Ware, Glenn Gregory, Peter Hook, Mark Allman, Dr. Clive from Doctor and the Medics, China Crisis, loads of old mates who I haven't seen, you know, so... And you're not there long enough to drive each other mad, but you're long enough there to be, and you know, get on well and share information and swap numbers and all that stuff. So yeah, I really enjoyed it. But the actual playing to great audiences and, it was great.
We love it. Honestly, we're singing full blast. We're so back after lockdown.
Come on.
Come on. Yeah, so we're going to go into the first song. Your iconic breakout hit, The Stories of the Blue Part 1.
Yes.
Which was released as a single in 1982.
Yeah.
And the band's biggest hit, reaching number 3 on the UK singles chart. Have I got all that information right, Pete?
Very good, except I would say we weren't really a band by then. It was me and Carl Washington was the bass player and that was it. I'd stopped wanting to be in a band for a while. Because I found it was limited. There were things I love about, there still are things I love about being in a band, like hanging out and trying things and, you know, noise. I love the noise and the laughter. But I'd started wanting to make records a different way. So Story of the Blues isn't really a band. It's me. Carl's on bass. Mike Hedges produced it. And there were some women who played string section and some women on backing vocals. But they were only on that one record, you know. So, yeah, it's first hit for Wah, but there are a million variations of Wah.
Got it.
I changed the name every time the music changed. I changed it, you know.
I like
that. I wanted people to know. I like it too.
Yeah, we like change.
I can't be bothered now, so I'm going to leave it as Pete Wiley, the Mighty Wah. That's
well, we
my
like
name
that
now.
Here on the show, and we're going to play out the song. And Pete and I will be catching up more after this. Back. We want to know everything about you because you were born in Liverpool.
I was born.
And you began your career in 1977. I want to know, was music something that you always wanted to do?
From when I was a kid, music almost saved me. You know, I was a bright kid. I am a, you know, a university boy. But I loved music from, you know, I suppose I had cousins in the early 60s who would be playing the Beatles and stuff like that. But from about 1967, 68, I just started obsessing about music to the point of, you know, some people thought it was a bit weird. And I devoured every fact I could find about people who made records, and not just the big hits, you know, looking into it and loving, you know, realised I love Motown, for example. And so music was a massive thing for me, but I liked, and I still do, like lots of different kinds. But then 1972, David Bowie he blew me mind. He blew me mind, and he absolutely changed everything for me. And he became like my chief obsession in a way. Although it's more than an obsession, you know, I still love his music. I love Black Star, the last album, as much as I love, you know, Ziggy Stardust. That's when I started playing guitar. Because I still sometimes think of myself as a guitarist, not as much as a front man or a singer. Although I like being a front man, I like being a singer. And I've got, one of the things on the Rewind tour was after I'd do my songs, I'd come off and people would be saying, wow, what a great voice. You've got a great voice. And I was saying, I kind of thought I always did that. But it's nice for them to get it now, you know.
Yes.
I got to know Ian McCulloch from Echo and the Bunnymen. I taught him guitar. And then, because he was a Bowie fan, that's how we met.
Right.
1977, 76, Eric's A Club in Liverpool opened, which coincided with punk rock. And that's when everything absolutely changed for me. I started university the Monday after, and I never really went because I wanted to be in Eric's. I wanted to be seeing those bands like the Sex Pistols and the Clash and the Ramones. But I also wanted to see the people who were going. I met people there like Pete Burns from Dead or Alive, Andy McCluskey from OMD, Budgie from Susie and the Banshees, Julian Cope, Ian McCulloch, Ian Brody, you know. I mean, there were a bunch of us, and we were all about the same age, and nobody told us we couldn't be rock stars, whereas I think if punk hadn't happened, we may not have gone that way, you know. I mean, I always wanted to be a rock star, but I would have not known how to go, what the process was, you know. So, you know, it was great. I started playing in bands. I was in a band with Julian Cope and Pete Burns called the Mystery Girls, and I wore my mother's clothes and a toilet seat.
Yeah, I love that.
Pete Burns was the singer, I was the guitarist, Julian was the bass player. And we supported Sham 69. I got headbutted on the way home by their fans. it went from there. And then 78, this is when university finished for me altogether. Me and Paul Rutherford from Frankie Goes to Hollywood, because Holly Johnson and Paul were part of our scene as well, and big part of it. And me and Paul loved the Clash. I love the Clash still to this day. And we started going on tour and following them. And they used to let people in the dressing room. There'd be like 200 people in the dressing room. But one night, Mick Jones said, of all the people who come round, you two have got something. I think you're going to be stars. And it was unbelievable, you know, really was. So in 1978, I followed the Clash round to the point whereby when they were filming a movie called Rude Boy, I roadied for them. Wow. You can see me in the film during Safe European Home. And me and Mick became mates, you know, as well as him being my hero.
God.
So, my life was absolutely changing then. And I'd started being in bands, but I was always the guitarist. And then one day, you know, I was in a band and I didn't like the singer. I still don't like him.
Bluntly.
I didn't know what kind of voice I had, but I knew I wanted to have a powerful voice, because I liked people like Frank Sinatra as much as I liked Joe Strummer. I liked Jim Morrison as much as I liked Johnny Rotten. So, the way I sang came out as a mixture of everything I've ever loved, and kind of big, and I've got a great range, which I never knew.
That's amazing that you had that voice on you, because I can't sing at all. But
you
had that
great
natural ability.
I had to have something. So
but I'm tone deaf.
So are most people, especially the ones who buy my records. That's not true. They're good records. I love them still. So I started making, we were at a kind of, War Heat, the first incarnation was like a guitar-led, indie, very intense thing. But about 1981 or two, I started reading books about and learning about other kinds of ways of making records, because I knew I wanted to do more than just guitar records. I even stopped playing guitar for a year to force myself to find other ways. And then I saw Boys from the Black Stuff, a TV series written by Alan Bleasdale about unemployment and the consequences of it. But what it did was, it didn't give out a rant or a, you must be like this. It told the emotional story of the effect on everyday human beings. And that rang such big banging bell in my head that I thought, that's how I want to write now. And that's where the story of the blues came from. directly.
Love that.
Yeah.
We could listen to your stories all day, Pete.
You will be.
We could just have storytellers with you. It's brilliant.
No, thank you. I like telling them. And they're all true. I never lie. I never exaggerate. I never tell anyone
else. He's keeping it real.
Always.
I like it.
Thank you.
Always.
Thank you.
Well, we're going to go into the next song, The Comeback by Mighty Wah, which is constantly played on Radio 1 evenings and championed by John Peel, yeah, who said it was the kind of record that knocks your socks off. John, one of our viewers, says, what was it like to have the hit for Cool Kids in the summer of 1984?
John Peel was a champion of us, and he became a mate, kind of. Still miss him. He had such an impact. He was another really important figure in my progress, but not just mine. Hundreds of other musicians had to step up via the John Peel show. You know, him and John Walters, his producer, were great. And they were funny, and they went... You felt like you... Even before I met him, I felt like I knew him.
Yeah.
And so it was weird, because I remember one of the first gigs we did after Story of the Blues was a hit, and we were still doing some of the angry guitar songs. And the audience who had only heard Story of the Blues would come, and they'd kind of look a bit confused, and, you know, this isn't like Story of the Blues. But then by Comeback, I'd well established that was the way I was going to go, you know. And I love Comeback. I played everything on it. I produced it. Because I often do that. I play all the stuff on my records because there are lots of reasons. But Comeback, I'm very proud of. And it's a song about Liverpool. It's a song connected to Story of the Blues. And it's part of an LP called A Word to the Wise Guy, which I kind of wrote as Boys from the Black Stuff, the musical. That was my idea.
All right.
So,
like,
you know.
Yeah.
I like it. Yeah, and I wrote it from different people's points of view, like the series was. So, yeah. That's going to get reissued next year in a big box set. So I'm looking forward to being able to tell more of these stories, you know.
Yes, we want story time part two. Well, we're going to play it out on the show right now. And Pete and I will be catching up with you after this.
Oh,
Now, Pete, we have got some questions from some of our lovely viewers.
You love questions. I've got lots of answers.
We've got to keep you quiet. Right.
What? I'm ready.
Margaret would like to know, what was it like before we went on Top of the Pops? And I would like to know that too, because I'm obsessed with it. Bring it back.
It was fantastic. It was fantastic doing Top of the Pops. Really, really fantastic. I mean, the day itself is kind of long and not much fun because you're under a director, you've got to do things by the book and all that stuff. But actually, it's something I've watched since I was a kid and I continue to watch. I went, all the way through, even when I didn't like much of the music, I still watch it. It's where I saw Bowie doing Starman. It's where, I felt like it said something about us achieving a level. And you met good people. I met some great people there, and obviously it automatically boosted your sales hugely.
Yeah, I can imagine.
So, which I didn't think about. That wasn't a key thing to me, but it helped, yeah. It helped.
Good times.
And so, yeah, I loved it. Story of the Blues, I got into trouble after that because it's a long story.
We've got time for this story. And they stopped.
Story of the Blues was outselling everything else at the time. Men at Work and Phil Collins were on the way down and we were number three. And we would have gone to number one. And we did Top of the Pops, and we were outselling them enough to go to number one. But we did a thing a lot of groups did in those days, which is you had to re-record the song in 3 hours. And I'd spent 6 months making Story of the Blues, so you swapped the tape, so you mime on Top of the Pops to the record. And we got away with it, and it was great, and everyone was happy, and somebody had forgotten to pay the bribe to the musicians' union person. And we got banned, and the record was penalised. And I would have had a number one then, which again, it dents your enthusiasm. So the next time was Come Back, Top of the Pops, and it was live and we were on first. So because we were on first, you rehearse it 3 or 4 times a day.
Yeah.
Come Back, they said to me, they came to me 5 minutes before it was due to start and said, look, because you're first on, we want to make sure we've got it right. So if you could just do Come Back, but you don't have to do anything. And then we'll tell you when we're ready. And then you do it again, but live that time. So I said, great. So we were all kind of hanging around the stage. And, the Come Back was playing in the background and we kind of made a light, kind of half interested performance because we wanted to save it for the main one. And all of a sudden behind the camera, Kid Jensen was going, it's on now. And I was going, what do you mean? What? And they'd cancelled the rehearsal thing and was straight into the live thing and no one told us. So the first half of the Top of the Pops had come back, which is on YouTube. I still think it's good, but the second half, when we realised what had happened, we got a bit more, I was angry, I was angry. Yeah. Plus I wanted to show off to make up for the first half. And, so we did. And then, I did it. I think I did it. Oh, Sinful was the next time. Sinful was great. We took on, I got some dancers who were in a Hot Gossip and stuff like that, but dressed them up in nuns in suspenders. And it made some people very, very happy. That's all I can say.
Speaking
of Sinful. Let me tell you one last thing.
Go on,
about
MP.
That.
Go on.
Sorry,
we'll
sorry.
You. 1 minute.
And John Peel presented it on Top of the Pops with Janice Long, my good mate. And he said, if this record doesn't go to number one, I'm going to come round and break wind in your kitchen. And he got loads of complaints. And so, I don't know whether he got the complaints for saying break wind in your kitchen or for not going round to everyone's house.
But, we'll never know. Well, thank you for sharing that with us, Pete. We're going to play out Sinful right now. Whoa, see you after.
I should've cried, I should've stayed.
fire question round for you because we want to get to know you better. Are you excited?
I love it.
He loves it. Right, first question. What is your driving song?
My driving song is Motorbiking by Chris Spedding because I just got a motorbike last week.
Oh, nice. Okay, like it. Favourite decade of music?
70s, without a doubt.
Really?
Because Bowie, because The Clash, because disco, because Jethro Tull, because loads of reasons.
It's great reasons. Best advice you've ever been given?
Don't talk to Hayley Palmer.
That's very good advice. Whoever told you that, like it. And something...
I ignored it. It was a girl called Linda told me.
He's in so much trouble. And something we don't know about you. Give us a fun
I'm
fact,
I'm an intellectual. I'm an intellectual. What else do you want to know? I broke me back in 1991. Some people
Did
know
you?
That. I nearly died. Oh, yeah. I nearly died in 9th of November, 1991. Just talking to a mate and leaned on a fence and it gave way. I wouldn't call it a fun fact, but it's a fact.
It is a fact.
Fun fact.
A fun fact about you, Pete, that the nation needs to know right
fact,
now.
There is no fun here. It's just one big circle of misery.
We don't believe you.
I know. Here's a fun. Do you want a fun fact? I think this is fun. I've got a painting of me, which was done around the time of the story of the blues in 1983 by Pete Townshend of The Who, one of my heroes. And he's just said that we can use it for the best of LP I'm going to do next year. Pete Townshend from The Who painted two pictures of me.
That is legendary.
Before
you
I ever met him.
That about you. We like that.
I love that. One of them's on the wall there, which I can't show you. And the other one is, it's going to be on an LP sleeve. What else fun facts?
Anything else
I'm
to
brilliant.
Add to that?
I'm incredibly attractive.
Well, we all didn't want to say anything, but yeah, thank you,
yeah.
Pete. And last question, what's your favourite takeaway? Important
My
question
My favourite
here.
Takeaway is free one. Anything.
Do you
anything
get free takeaways?
If you're clever, you can.
Oh, right,
especially,
okay.
There's a chip shop around the corner that it's run by Liverpool fans. And because my song, Heart as Big as Liverpool, gets played every Liverpool match.
So you get free
And because
chips.
Of that, I get free chips.
Wow.
And a free Mr. Whippy as well. I get a free Mr. Whippy because they play Heart as Big as Liverpool at Anfield. So, you know.
Honestly, that was absolute gold. I'm so jealous.
That is gold.
Yeah.
And it's a good fun fact.
That is a fun fact. See, we got there in the end, Pete.
There's loads.
We're
going to
play out If I Love You from 1987. Where was this video actually filmed? I was trying to work it out.
It was filmed in the Joshua Tree Desert in America, where Gram Parsons died, where lots of cool people went off and did stuff. It's amazing. I was in America, living in America for a while. And the record company had said, they didn't like the English video style, not just me, of the way English people made videos. And they made two videos. And If I Love You was one of the best videos I remember making, you know, except for the bit where he says, now you've got to drive a car. And I can't drive cars.
Oh.
And so we got the model who was in it to drive.
Oh,
and I just sang in the back of the car. It was fabulous. Yeah, it was amazing. I've still got... like the speaker that you get in a drive-in movie, I found in the Joshua Tree Desert, like a 50s thing, and I've still got that. I mean, I've got lots of souvenirs and things, you know, but yeah.
Like it. We're going to play out the video right now, and we can't wait to see you after.
Of a long road with a sack full of big deals, one eye on the way ahead, the other on the opening rails. I was thinking how we look for some perfect thing that I don't think could be defined. When I saw something put you on my mind, I saw talking, loving, don't and do's, and it's strong.
something even more exciting than the free chips, Pete. You've got some exclusive news for us on the show. Hit us.
Well, I am delighted to say that I've just confirmed today that I'm going to go on tour with Heaven 17 in November. Ooh. From Bonfire Night. For, there are 10 shows in November. And because I saw them again, as I said, you know, we had a reunion in Rewind. And, yeah, we got on really well. They were saying, you know, Martin and Glenn were saying how much they liked my voice. And I wanted to work with them before, but I wasn't able to. And so, yeah, got the call this week. I'm going to do those shows, and I can't wait, you know, because they're great people as well. And, in fact, on the Rewind shows, their backing singers sang with me on Story of the Blues and Come Back and Sinful. And so I'm really looking forward to that because I love the people. I love their politics. I love their music, obviously. And I'd rather work with people who I get on with, you know. And so, and then next year I'm going to do some quite big shows, which I can't tell you about yet. But you've got to come back, that means. Come back.
Hey. So the tour with Heaven 17, so it's from the 5th of November. How many dates is it? Do you know any more info?
There are 10. I've got a list somewhere. There are 10. But I know there's London, there's Liverpool, there's...
We'll put details on the screen of how people can find out about that.
I'll send it to you in a little while.
Okay, great. Brilliant.
So thank you for mentioning.
We're going to go into the next song, 411:44. This is a really interesting song. Was it based on anyone at all?
Well, yes and no in that.
Okay.
It was to some extent about Josie, who was in the band with me, and Josie passed away 4 years ago, and we were cancer, but she was one of the greatest human beings I ever met. We were lovers for 3 years, but we stayed mates all the way through, and I still miss her to this day. So it was sort of written about when we broke up, except it wasn't in that.
Right.
I hated the way every love song seemed to be telling you what you had to do. You know, here's like a manual to being in love or in a relationship, and I nobody ever gave me it if one existed. And I wanted to write a song where love and what it takes to love somebody is beyond definition. And that's why I chose the title, which I've told people over the years, lots of different ways of meanings for 411:44.
Yeah.
But there's a big one, which is it was an American thing that people called a lucky charm, 411:44, or a lucky ticket. So it was like, here's a bit of luck. Love is also about luck to me, you know. I think there are many people who will agree with that. And so I wanted to write a song which didn't say, this is what love is about, and give it a title that would make people ask questions but didn't give any orders. And that's why, like, the lyrics are, you know, my love is a rainbow and my love is falling grey rain. Because, you know, people aren't just one thing. Nobody is just one thing. You know, and there's a range of stuff, and A to Z's and Alpha to Omega are all in the song. That's what I was trying to say. But also that, you know, I loved somebody and we'd broken up, and people do break up. So it's the history of love in one song.
We love it here on the show. We're going to play it out now, and we'll see you after this.
My love is a rainbow and my love is falling grey rain. My love is a rainbow and my love is falling grey rain. My love is a rainbow from violet to red. She's infra and ultra and all A to Z. And she said, she is for a lover. like a tiger, sleeps like a Siamese. Ooh, she'll charm and she'll tease until you've had enough, but you'll never back down when you call in her bluff. And she'll say, and she'll say, she is for 1144. She's deep and she's shallow, not only skin deep, she's a beauty in black, and she's wolf dressed as she has.
To finish.
Great.
On a scale of 1 to 10, how much fun has this been?
This is the best day of my life ever. Although I'll have to tell my daughter tomorrow that her being born has got just moved down one. I love it, Hayley. I've really enjoyed it. I like you,
No, you've been so much fun, and I'm dead jealous that you're getting free chips. I need to work on that for myself. That's like an actual goal in my week.
I will bring you to Liverpool. That. I'll bring you up here and get you fed properly for nothing.
I'd love it in Liverpool, I know I would. But no, thank Brilliant. You so much. We want to remind everyone to get tickets for you and Heaven 17, which Great. Is coming in November. So we're going to put details yep. on the screen below to remind everyone. But thank you. We've loved story time with
thank
Pete
you.
Wiley. It's been brilliant. And also, we want to know how your cats are as well, because you've got 3 cats, haven't you?
The cats are thriving. I adopted them from the front garden 3 years ago. There's a mum and her twins. There's Roxy, after Roxy Music, is the mum, and Iggy and Ziggy, after Bowie and Iggy, obviously, are the twins. And they are, to some extent, a little bit feral still. I rescued them. Nobody else would take them, and the charities couldn't house them. And I was allergic to cats, and I still am. But you know what? They were the mates I wanted during lockdown, and they were fantastic. And in fact, I'll send you a picture of them. Which is I use as a screensaver because they're wild, but they pose all the time. You don't have to tell them; they just do it. So
I can relate to that.
Yeah, you are made for me.
Pete Wiley, this has been absolutely brilliant. We've learned a lot on the show, and thank you so much for your time and energy.
Thank you, Hayley. I love it, love it, love it.
It's have Pete a great Wiley, life. Everyone. Woo!
Lights go out forever, somewhere near the end of time. The noise will pass and the dust will settle, and you'll be on my mind. Now you won't find it hard to understand. sing.
Same time, same place next week, and we're going to leave you with Saturday Night's Song of the Week by John Gallier.
Hey guys, it's John Gallier here. I can't believe this month marks 10 years since the release of my very first ever single, Do It My Way. I remember it was like yesterday being in the studio, and we wanted to create something uplifting and anthemic, and the reaction from you guys has been amazing, so thank you. And to celebrate, I've teamed up with remixer Matt Pop with a very special 10th anniversary remix, which is now available on Spotify and all streaming platforms. So hope you're good, and happy birthday, Do It My Way.